أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: يا بني آدم قد أنزلنا عليكم لباسا يواري سوآتكم وريشا ولباس التقوى ذلك خير ذلك من آيات الله لعلهم يذكرون. صلوات عليكم. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless everyone for this holy month of Ramadan. We have already concluded half of the month. And inshallah, during the other half that I'm back here at the center, besides the major nights from the eve of 19th till about 21st, 22nd of Ramadan, where the topic would be different, inshallah, we will be looking at a section from Saif al-Sajjadiyya in our briefly talks that we have. But to begin with, let me, you know, start with a verse from the Quran that I recited earlier from Surah Al-A'raf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about what I consider to be an issue of moving from ritual to spiritual. It's very interesting the way Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very quickly moves from one level to another level of discussion. The ayat initially basically is talking about the physical garment. Ya bani Adam, O the children of Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يَوْآرِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. That we have sent down garments. Now, it doesn't mean that there are tailors up there working for us. It means that Allah has given us the raw material and the intelligence and the ability to use the raw material that He has created for us to make garments for ourselves, from whether it is from things which grow or even from Marisha, referring to the feather and the hide of the animals that we can use. And then, now this is very interesting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talks about this issue, He's mentioning that as a blessing. Now, what is the function of libas? Libas basically has, number one, we see there that it basically covers us, as the ayat says, so that you can cover your private parts. Besides that, it's also a means of adorning ourselves. We don't go out without clothes. You know, this is how we make ourselves more presentable. And clothes also help us in protecting our body against extreme weathers. And then immediately the ayat, and this is where I'm saying Allah moves from ritual to spiritual level. Then He immediately says, "Wal libasu taqwa, dhalika khayr." But then the garment of righteousness, the garment of piety, that is better. It doesn't mean you leave the normal clothes and wear that. And this is where we have to think about it. You know, ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ. These are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that you may reflect and remember the reality. Now this, you know, moving from the physical garment immediately to spiritual garment. This is the beauty of Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us realize that yes, the garments that we have, Allah has given to us the resources to make them. These are all good things. These are blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have to thank Him for it. But immediately Allah says, remember there is another kind of garment, which is not a physical one, which you cannot buy from, you know, department stores, neither from Tabligh store or a religious store. You can't even buy it in Karbala or Najaf or Qom or Mashhad. No. This is a spiritual clothing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ. This is the good one. And this is where, you know, I would like to use this ayat here as the basis of the discussion that we will have for about maybe 5 or 6 evenings, you know, tomorrow night, and then we'll go after Layali al-Qadr. We'll go back to the themes. What is this libas al-taqwa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about? We have to realize that, you know, the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically a very brief message. And if you want to see the elaboration of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is where you go to the ahadith of the Ma'sumin. So Allah's message, when it's summarized, it is known as the Quran. When it is explained in more elaboration and detail, it becomes the hadith of the Ma'sumin, the Prophet and the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. And for this particular, you know, theme of what is libas al-taqwa, the garment of, you know, piety or righteousness, I would like to go to Sayf al-Sajjadiyya of our fourth Imam, Imam Zainul Abidin, alayhi salatu wasalam. In that book of dua, there is a very famous dua known as Dua Makarim al-Akhlaq. Dua-i Makarim al-Akhlaq is a very eloquent, very powerful dua, although we normally only recite it once a year as a community, on the eve of 23rd of Ramadan. And in that, and I'm not even going into the whole dua, I wouldn't be able to do that in the 6 days that we have, but in the 10th passage of it, we don't use the terms ayat, but this, you know, du'as are divided into different sections, just like the ayat of Quran. And the 10th passage of Du'a Makarim al-Akhlaq actually begins with two statements which are very powerful. And that links me to this concept of libas al-taqwa. In one, we are praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where the fourth Imam says that, say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa alih wa hallini bi hulyati as-salihin wa albisni zinat al-muttaqin. If you look at these two statements, after asking for Allah's blessing on the Prophet and his family, we say, oh Allah, hallini bi hulyati as-salihin, adorn me with the adornment of those who are salihin, the good doers, the righteous people. Wa albisni, from libas, cover me, clothe me with zinat al-muttaqin, with something which is known as the ornament of the pious. And this is where we have to realize that libas al-taqwa in Surah Araf and this Hulyat al-Salihin and Zinat al-Muttaqin, these are connected to one another. And under this, in the same passage, the 10th passage of Dua Makarim al-Akhlaq, our fourth Imam actually gives about 17 to 19 qualities that we should acquire, and that is how we will be able to build for ourselves what is known as Libas al-Taqwa. Before I continue, and tonight we'll just look at one of that quality that Imam have. I have tried to put together at least two of them in every session. So by the sixth session, we will have at least 12 qualities. But before I go to that, let us have a quiz. I want to see, you know, for 20 years plus I'm here, what is the standard? Okay, so it's not just, you know, it's test for myself also. And so, if you have your mobile phones on, you can go to this website, menti.com, and use code number 611842. Okay, we have about 61, 65. Okay. Let us start with the first question. Get ready. Was Sahife Sajjadiya number one written by the fourth Imam himself or compiled by someone else like Nahjul Balagha, compiled by Sayyid Razi, consisting of the khutbas of the Imam? Okay, we have 53 people have given the right answer. So it means it's a good job I'm doing here. Alhamdulillah. Okay. Now, the very first thing that the Imam has mentioned here, just to, emphasize this question that Sayyif al-Sajjadiyya actually is a book of the Imam himself, unlike Nahjul Balagha, which was a book compiled later on by Sayyid Razi from the khutbas and sayings and letters of the Imam. The very first thing that Imam talks about is the issue of that, Allah give me this adornment of righteous and the ornament of the pious in the act of spreading justice. It's not only adl by itself, bastil adl, spreading the phenomenon or the reality of justice. We know that when it comes to the issue of justice in Islam, this is considered to be a very important issue. There are ayat of Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the main reason why he sent down prophets and messengers to human society was actually for establishing fairness and justice in the society. For example, in Surah number 57, ayah 25, he says, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُولَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنْزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانِ, that we sent our messengers with very clear guidelines, and we sent book and scale of what is right and wrong, لِيَقُومَ النَّاسِ بِالْقِسْطِ, so that people may, establish themselves on the basis of justice and fairness. There are three places in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ, Allah loves those who deal with fairness and justice. Not only that, if you look at ilm al-akhlaq, justice is actually the core quality of righteousness and piety. All other qualities that we talk about, if it is on one extreme, there is a weakness. If it is on other extreme, again, there is a problem. If you are able to maintain that quality at a medium level, that is known as adl. So adl actually is there as a criteria for all other qualities also. The emphasis that we have, especially in Shia Islam, we look at our usul al-din. After tawheed, we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say that he also, we believe, is adil. When we talk about anbiya and mursaleen, we say they must be adil. When we talk about our religious guides, our mujtahideen and maraji, it's not only their academic, credentials which are important. Even their character is very important, otherwise their views would not be followed. We might consider it for academic discussion, but not follow them. There also adalat, upright character, is an important issue. Even for a simple imam of jamaat, is the condition is that, at least in the community, he should be known to be a person who is not openly committing sins. And so this concept of justice, especially in the Shi'i, perspective of Islam, is all the way from divinity to the level of the common, human beings. Even when it comes to the issue of how we deal with our enemies, that is where we have to realize that even when we deal with our enemies, there also justice is requirement. In Surah number 5, ayat 8, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ لِلَّهِ شُهَدَاءَ بِالْقِسْطِ. O you who believe, this is me and you, it's not somebody else. The problem is when we read Quran, we say, oh, okay, Quran is, Allah is talking to the mu'mineen, a group out there. No, he's talking to you directly. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كونوا قوامين لله. Be the people who are upright for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. شهداء بالقسط. Who actually stand up in testifying what is just and fair. ولا يجرمنكم شنعان قوم على أن لا تعدلوا. And do not let, you know, hatred of a people. Maybe there are people who have been very bad to you. And you, in a way, have a right to feel bad about them, even to hate them. But even that hatred, on a justified basis also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not let it push you to the extent that you do not deal with them on the basis of justice, adl, and fairness. اعدلوا. You know, maintain justice. هو أقرب للتقوى. That is closer to the whole issue of righteousness and piety. واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Allah knows everything that we do. I think the most important point of justice is when we have to make a judgment about ourselves. And that is actually the mark of a true صالح and a true متقي. And a true follower of, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And this actually brings me to another quality in this list of 17 to 19 things that Imam Zain al-Abidin mentions. Bast al-adl, and then later in the list he says, wal-qawl bil-haq wa-in azza. To say the truth, even if it's going to be painful and difficult, even if it is going against yourself. And this is where we see, for example, in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kunu qawwamina bilqist, O you who believe, be upright in the matters of justice, shuhada lillah, be witnesses for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, walaw ala anfusikum. Even if you have to testify against yourself, against your worldly interest, you have to maintain justice. Wal walidain. And even if you know you have to testify against your parents, it's going against them. You cannot say, oh, Allah says we have to have silatul rahim. Silatul rahim with zulm wouldn't work. Adl has to be maintained. Wal aqrabin, and those who are near and dear to us. And they among them also, in yakun ghaniyan aw faqiran. Don't look at whether he is rich or poor. You know, maybe I should testify in his favor, maybe he will favor me later on. No. Whether they are faqir or ghani, rich or poor, doesn't matter. Fallahu awla bihima. It is better for you to have closer relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا تَطَّبِعُوا الْحَوَىٰ أَن تَعْدِلُوا. Do not follow your desires that you may move away from adl. And then, you know, the ayat goes on. And this is where, you know, we have to realize that adl is not only talking about others, actually maintaining that adl in case of ourselves, our families, and even those who are close to us. Let us now go to another question. Who is the first narrator of As-Sahifa Sajjadiyya? Is it Abu Hamza of Fumali, a very close companion of the Imam, or Zayd al-Shaheed, or Imam Muhammad al-Baqir? Okay, good. Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, as well as Zayd al-Shaheed, both are brothers. And this Sahifa Sajjadiyya has come to us from both channels of Imam Muhammad al-Baqir as well as his son Zayd bin Ali al-Shaheed. Okay. Let me now end with one example from the life of the prophet himself on this issue. And this is a narration from Sheikh Saduq in his Al-Amali. Through his narration, he talks about one of the last days before the wafat of the Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where he gathered the people, he told Bilal, gathered the community. And then he says that, you know, I ask you in the name of Allah that if there is anyone among you who has a right upon me, I want that person to stand up now and get his right from me, because I don't want to face the situation on the day of judgment. I would rather deal with it in this dunya. When we talk about this issue of the rights of other people from the perspective of justice and equality. And this is where, you know, a person stood up at the back by the name of Sawada bin Qais, and he says to the Prophet, you know, of course, in a very respectful manner, he says, one day when you were coming back from Taif, one of the journeys after Mecca, you came close to me and you were riding your camel, and you had this whip to, you know, hit the animal. And you lifted it this way before you hit the animal. And while you were doing that, I was at the back and it hit me. And the Prophet says, Ma'adhallah an akuna ta'ammadtu. If that happened, I didn't do it intentionally. Now, according to the Sharia laws, because it was not something done intentionally, qisas doesn't apply, which means retaliation would not be applicable there. The other person cannot say, because I was hit by your whip, so I have a right to do the same to you. According to the laws, basically in that case, because the person didn't see what's going on at the back, you know, the victim in that case can only ask for some monetary compensation. But Rasulullah is setting an example for us. So he says to Bilal, Ya Bilal, قم إلى منزل إلى منزل فاطمة. Go to the house of Fatima and ask her that the whip that I used in that journey, bring it here. Bilal goes. The Prophet is ordered, he can't really disobey him, but very much distressed. And he was saying loudly in the streets of Medina, look at the day now. A person has stood up to do qisas and retaliation against Rasulullah. And the Prophet says, I would rather do it here rather than wait for it on the day of Qiyamah. So he says, I went to the house of Fatima, knocked on the door, and I said, you know, Fatima, your father wants this whip. And she says, but for what? He was not even feeling well. This is not the day for that. Why would he need it? And this is where Bilal says, your father is on the minbar. This is what he is saying to the people, and he wants it. Fatima cried, of course, you know, and she gave that whip to Bilal. You know, she was crying that, you know, how can I, you know, see such a day where my father is the father of the poor and the miskin and those who travelers who are stranded. وحبيب الله وحبيب القلوب. Everybody loves him. But anyway, the Prophet had asked for the whip. So he goes there to the Prophet. He gave it to him. And Rasulullah asked this person, come and take your right, because I don't want to leave this dunya with anyone's haq on me. And this is where the person says, at that time, my back, where the hip touched me or hit me, was bare. So I would like you to lift your shirt. Rasulullah did that. And this is where this old person says, Bi'abi anta wa ummi ya Rasulullah. May my parents be sacrificed for you. I want the permission to kiss your back. He was actually using this, the whole issue, as an opportunity to kiss the back of Rasulullah so that I may be released from the fire of Jahannam in the Akhirah. And Rasulullah prays for him. And this is where we see that, you know, when it comes to the issue of justice, even if it's against yourself, if the time is there and the demand is there, you have to stand up. It is better to deal with issues in this dunya than let it go for the day of Akhirah. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار برحمتك يا رحم الراحمين.